हमारे लेटेस्ट अपडेट्स पाने के लिए चैनल को सब्सक्राइब करें और बेल आइकन को दबाना बिल्कुल ना भूलें, ताकि हमारे सभी नोटिफिकेशंस आपको सबसे पहले मिले। Digimento Education is India's best platform to prepare for GATE, NTA, UGC, NET and PGT Computer Science. ज्यादा जानकारी के लिए हमारी वेबसाइट www.digimento.com पर विजिट करें।
Hello everyone, have you ever thought what will you do after BTEC? So in this video, we will try and answer this question about what are your career opportunities and options after BTEC. So there are two kinds of people here. Those who say that after BTEC, they want to go to some non-technical side. For example, they want to get a non-technical job, administrative jobs from SSC, UPSC. And there are few people who thinks that they have spent almost 4 years studying all the technologies, studying the technical side. So they want to get a job in a technical domain. So in this video, majorly we will be focusing on the technical domain only. We will not be focusing on non-technical domain. You will understand the reason why I am saying that we want to focus on technical domain here. Okay. So when you want to focus on this technical domain, so after your BTEC, you are having basically four major choices. Let us see all of these choices one by one. So the first choice is that some of you may want to go for the private jobs. That means you want to go for a private company. Some of you might want to go for public sector undertakings, or you can say PSUs. And some of you might want to go for government jobs, and some of you might want to go for higher studies. So let us analyze each of these step by step. We'll try to understand each of these step by step, their pros, their cons, and how can you get selected, how can you choose this particular side. We'll try to answer each of these questions one by one. So the first one here is your private jobs. So when I'm saying private jobs, it is majorly your IT company jobs, IT companies. So in IT companies, you have three different kinds of IT companies. You can categorize them in three different categories. Number one is the tier one companies. Then we have tier 2 companies, and then we have tier 3 companies. So what are these tier 1 companies? The tier 1 companies ka matlab kya hai? What are these tier 1 companies? So these tier 1 companies are companies like Microsoft, Google, Facebook, Qualcomm. There are a lot of companies which are basically products based companies. So most of these tier 1 companies are your product based companies. They are products based companies. Okay, so a lot of companies which come under this category, as I said. And why I'm calling them as tier 1, tier 2, tier 3? So there are two major criteria here. What is the size of the company, their annual revenue, plus what is the amount of salary package they're offering to the freshers. So for example, here if you see these tier 1 companies, so they offer an average salary package between 12 to 18 lakhs per annum to the fresh graduates. But the problem is they only recruit from premier colleges. Maybe for example, if you see from IITs, some of the top IITs, they will recruit from some of the top premier institutions, central universities, top NITs. So they will not recruit the candidates, the people from local colleges. They will only recruit the people from premier institutions. But then we have these tier 2 companies, and these tier 2 companies are companies like Adobe. So a lot of companies are there. So in these tier 2 companies, you get a salary package between 6 lakhs per annum to approximately 12 lakhs per annum. And then we have tier 3 companies here. So these tier 3 companies are having a salary package below 6 lakhs per annum. So here there are many tier 3 companies here. For example, you see Infosys, Wipro. So all of these companies who are mass recruiters, they come under the category of tier 3 companies. These tier 3 companies generally hire candidates even from local colleges, and they can hire candidates from any discipline. Doesn't matter. Maybe you are from a computer science background, you have done your BTEC from IT or computer science, or maybe you have done your BTEC from electronics and communication. Maybe you have done your BTEC from mechanical or civil. So do not really care. All they want is that you should have a good aptitude skills, and you should have good communication skills. If you have good aptitude skills, good communication skills, these tier 3 companies will hire you. But after this, they will train you on their technologies. And most of the jobs that you will get in these tier 3 companies, that will not be hardcore developer job. They will be mostly like testing jobs or assistant kind of job. These jobs you will get in tier 3 companies. Okay. And in tier 2 companies, let us go through their interview process one by one. If you look at these tier 3 companies, let us figure out their interview process. So in these tier 3 companies, you get an aptitude test. You have to give an aptitude test. Then there will be a group discussion. And after this group discussion, you will go for personal interview as well as technical interview. So basically, they do not give a lot of preference to these technical interviews. They mostly give preference to this aptitude skills and the group discussions. So these, they'll hardly ask like 3 to 4 questions, which are very, very basic questions. Questions like, what is object-oriented programming language? What is polymorphism? What is inheritance? Very simple, basic school level questions. But when you go for these tier 2 companies, these tier 2 companies majorly focus that you should have some knowledge regarding a specific technology. Maybe you have some good knowledge regarding Java. Maybe you have some good knowledge regarding .NET framework. Maybe you have some good knowledge regarding some programming language. So they take your test. So in that test, you have to give both aptitude test plus you have to give your technical. After this, they take your group discussions. Then you have a technical round. And after this, you have HR round. So they give some preference to your technical abilities. After this, you have tier 1 companies. And these tier 1 companies look for the candidates who are hardcore problem solvers. I mean to say that you have some good knowledge of competitive programming. So you should have some good knowledge for algorithms. You should have some good knowledge for problem solving, right? And data structures and operating system and computer networks. So if you have good knowledge for each of these core subjects, then you are really eligible for these tier 1 companies. Okay. Plus they give some preference to aptitude, but majorly they also focus on the core computer science knowledge here. Now we will look for, we will discuss how you can get selected in these tier 1 and tier 2 companies, how can you can focus on that. We will discuss about it in more details. Then we have public sector undertakings. So what do we really mean by public sector undertaking? So these public sector undertakings are the companies where there's a public and private partnership. Public partnership means government and private means the private companies. For example, you have BHEL, Bharat Heavy Electricals Limited. You have Delhi DMRC, Delhi Metro Rail Corporation. You have NTPC, you have ONGC. So these are some major names in PSUs. So some of these PSUs are having 51% partnership by the government, maybe central government. And some of these, and 49% from private companies. And some of these PSUs are having 51% partnership from government, from private companies, and 49% from government, like this. So here, these PSUs are basically in two categories. One is your center PSUs, which are centrally owned by the central government. And second one is the PSUs, which are owned by the state government. So central government, for example, again, these are defined in three different categories. We have Maharatna PSU, we have Navratna PSU, we have a Mini Ratna PSU. We will discuss about what are the companies which are in Maharatna, what are the companies which are in Navratna, what are the companies which are in Mini Ratna, as well as what are these category 1 Mini Ratna and category 2 Mini Ratna. So we'll discuss that. And then these state PSU means these are the PSUs which are owned by your state government. For example, Punjab State Electricity Board. So for every state, they have some PSUs which are owned by and governed by the state government, and there are some PSUs which are owned by the central government. Okay, so let me give you some ideas, some of the examples of Maharatna, Navratna, and Mini Ratna. Then you will be able to understand because of that. Okay. So here you can see this is the criteria. I've taken this from Wikipedia. So this is the criteria regarding the eligibility. When can we say that this PSU is a Maharatna PSU? When can we say this PSU is a Navratna PSU? And when can we say that this PSU is a Mini Ratna Category 1 or Mini Ratna Category 2 PSU? So Maharatna PSU means that means these PSUs should have average annual turnover and average annual net profit of 2500 crores or plus. In the same way, they can also say, or as you can see, this is an or category, either this condition should be true or this condition should be true. So you can read their eligibility, when can we say that PSU is a Maharatna, when can we say that PSU is a Mini Ratna? Okay, but I can give a list, because giving a list will help you to understand it more. For example, so these are the list of Maharatna PSUs. So approximately these are 10 Maharatna PSUs that we have. The first one is NTPC, the next one is ONGC. ONGC is a very, you know, good recruiter, right? Then we have SAIL, BHEL, IOCL, Indian Oil Corporation Limited, we have HPCL, we have CIL, we have GAIL, BPCL, Power Grid. All these are your Maharatna PSUs. And then these are the list of your Navratna PSUs. You can count them, how many Navratna PSUs are there. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. So approximately 14 PSUs are in the list of Navratna PSUs, and approximately 10 PSUs are in the list of Maharatna PSUs. So even your PSUs like MTNL, right? So MTNL, as you can see here, MTNL comes under the category of Navratna PSU. You have NBCC, because why I'm saying these names, because you guys are very, very, you know these names, you hear these names on your day-to-day life. So MTNL is very famous, NBCC is very famous, HAL is very famous. HAL is Hindustan Aeronautical Limited. So basically HAL creates helicopters. So India is not very famous for its fighter jets, but rather India is very famous for its helicopters. India produces world quality helicopters. So HAL is Hindustan Aeronautical Limited. Then you must have heard Oil India Limited. You must have heard this Concord, which is Containers Corporation of India, BEL, Bharat Electricals Limited, and so on. So these are the list of your Navratna PSUs. But now the list of Mini Ratna category 1 and category 2 is very lengthy. Let me show you the list. So as you can see here, I'm not sure if it is visible to all of you guys. If it is visible, then it's good. If it is not, then maybe I can take a few names here. So here you can clearly see Airport Authority of India is a Mini Ratna PSU. Your BSNL, Bharat Sanchar Nigam Limited, is a Mini Ratna PSU. And then again, some of these are famous, okay? And I think you must have heard this one also, Balmer Lorry. And then you have Hindustan Copper, HCL. You have, lot of PSUs are there, as you can see here. And these all PSUs comes under the category of Mini Ratna Category 1. And then we have Mini Ratna Category 2. So this is the list of PSUs which comes under the category of Mini Ratna Category 2 PSUs. So now I am talking about these PSUs here, because in these PSUs you have entries, technical entries for engineers. So they take engineers as an assistant engineer, they take executive engineers, and they take your junior engineers. So they release vacancies for engineer entries. And then we have government jobs. So government jobs in various government departments, maybe some of these jobs they recruit from SSC JEE, okay? And some of these jobs are regarding assistant engineer, some of these jobs are regarding junior engineer. Maybe for example, in electrical department, they release the entries for junior engineer as well as assistant engineer. And then you have teaching field, as you can see. So teaching is also a very booming field nowadays. Even the salaries for government professors, assistant professors are very, very high. So here, if I talk about this teaching field, so here we have mostly we have four major kinds of entries in teaching. One is your PRT teacher. So PRT teacher means someone who teaches below fifth class in government schools. Maybe you are teaching in a Kendra Vidyalaya Sangathan, KVS, you are teaching in a NBS, Navodaya Sangathan, and so on. So below fifth class teacher is PRT teacher. Then if you want to prepare from fifth class to 10th class, then they are called as TGT teachers, fifth, who teaches students from fifth to 10th class. And after this you have PGT teachers, I mean the teachers who teaches from 10th onwards, 11th and 12th classes. So these all are the entries for school teachers, right? So for PGT teacher, the eligibility criteria is that you should have done BTech. For TGT teacher, the eligibility criteria is you should have done BTech. There is no B.Ed is required. B.Ed is not required at all, okay? Now, so we get entries for PGT computer science, we also get entries for TGT computer science. So nowadays, if you can see it, so in DSSB, that is Delhi Subordinate Selection Board, they have released the entries for PGT as well as TGT. And then you have entries for lecturer in colleges, you have entries for assistant professor, you have entries for associate professors, and you have entries for professors. So again, these are different levels, and these levels are mostly in colleges. Okay, so for lecturer, if you want to get entry in a government college as a lecturer, then you should have done at least an M.Tech. For assistant professor, you should have done your M.Tech. Maybe if you are having PhD, that is a good point, because that is going to help you. And you should have qualified some of the examinations. You should have qualified GATE, or you should have qualified UGC NET. Now, here for associate professor, you should have PhD plus 5 years of experience. And then for professors, you should have PhD plus 10 plus years of experience. So according to the experience level, they categorized this lecturer, assistant professor, professors, and associate professor. And then there are other government jobs also. For example, there are jobs in a patent officer. So this is patent officer job. So a lot of government jobs are there where they take entries for B.Tech computer science people. And then you might want to go for higher studies here. So higher studies means either you want to go for M.Tech or ME. You want to go for MS, Master of Science. You want to go for PhDs. So there's a small difference between M.Tech and MS, because in other countries, like MS is very famous, but India, people prefer doing M.Tech or ME. So we can discuss a lot more about them in detail, but as of now, because I'm just giving a brief introduction about the career choices that you have, let me briefly describe them. So in M.Tech or ME, you have either you can do it from your top IIT, or you can do it from a normal college. So doing it from top IITs or from NITs, it is a good choice, because that is going to give you an entry in these premier colleges, and you can get entry in the tier 1 companies, correct? But doing the M.Tech and ME from a local college, that is not a very wise choice, because as you can see, again after M.Tech and ME, you will not be getting a good job opportunity. So if you want to do the M.Tech for a good job opportunities, it is better that you do M.Tech from top colleges. Now for this M.Tech, there are two kinds of courses in IITs. Maybe if you are discussing about IIT Bombay, or if you are discussing about IIT Bangalore, so they have for TA, M.Tech TA, which is teaching assistantship, and they take an M.Tech for RA, which is research assistantship. So we will discuss about this TA and RA in more details when we will be discussing more about GATE examination, that I am going to discuss about them in a lot of detail. So what is the difference between M.Tech and ME? So nowadays, the difference between them is very, very minute, very minute. But earlier there used to be big difference. ME is more into core side. ME is, that is Master of Engineering, is more focused towards giving a core subject knowledge. But when I discuss about these M.Tech, so these M.Tech are designed to give you, to prepare you for industry experiences. So these M.Tech courses are mostly, majorly you are going to study concepts regarding some programming languages, you are going to study concepts regarding your advanced database management systems and so on, because they are more industry focused. ME is more core branch focused, right? Core in the sense, like you have, majorly you are going to study your computer networks, you are going to study operating systems, or all these course concepts, core subjects, you are going to focus on that. And secondly, in case of M.Tech, you have a total, in some places in M.Tech, they prefer that you do 1 year of coursework in the college and then 1 year and 6 months of experience in the industry. But here in ME, they do not have any such things. They prefer that you should have 6 months of research experience. So they teach 1.5 years of coursework, and then last 6 months is spent doing writing some research papers, doing some research in ME. So majorly they are more about getting a job. But then this MS is more about doing the research. So you can call this MS as a mini PhD. It is mini PhD, right? Because you are going to do a lot of research here. In MS, mostly it happens like you have 1.5 year of studies, you have 1.5 year of coursework, and then you spend last 1 year in doing research. In some of the places, so it is not like very fixed. It depends on university to university how they design their curriculum. In some of the places, they prefer like you have 1 year of course experience and 1.5 year of research. And then these PhDs, again, you can what are PhDs, right? So you focus on doing the research. So why I have written PhD here? So this is very, very good question, right? Because people do M.Tech or people do their masters and then they go for PhD. But why I have written PhD here? What is the use of this? So basically, directly there's a provision that after BTech you can directly do PhD. You do not have to do your masters. Masters zaruri nahi hai. Even without doing a master, you can do PhD here. So let us look at how you can, you know, prepare for all of them. How can you go for them? So as I said, these tier 1 companies and tier 2 companies, they are only going to recruit from the top colleges, top universities, central universities, NITs and so on. They are not going to recruit from any of the local colleges, right? So if you want to prepare for tier 1 and tier 2 companies, it is better that you prepare for the GATE examination, because if you want to get entry in top IITs, so in the IITs, they will consider your GATE score. According to your GATE score, according to your GATE rank, you will get an IIT. And from there you can get into this top colleges. Okay, but secondly, so some of these companies, let us suppose I can take an example of Cisco. So some of these companies take the technical examination before entry, and the syllabus for technical exam and the questions and the level of questions in the technical exam is very much similar to your GATE exam. So again, if you want to get into this, so it is very beneficial for you to prepare for GATE examination. Secondly, so these PSUs, there are many PSUs who recruit from GATE examination. Let me show you the list. So I have the data from GATE 2020, because just now we finished the GATE 2020. Now we are preparing for GATE 2021. So there are many PSUs who are going to recruit from GATE 2020. So for example, we have BHEL, we have GAIL, HAL, IOCL, NTPC, NPCIL, ONGC, PGCIL. So these are some of the PSUs which are recruiting from GATE 2020. And one of the PSU which is giving the highest salaries here is ONGC. So ONGC is offering an average salary package of approximately 14 to 15 lakhs. So this is basically your CTC. This 14 to 15 lakhs is your CTC. So if you want to prepare for these PSUs, right, so there are more PSUs are also there. So for these PSUs, you have to prepare for GATE exemption. And even some of the group A level post in the government, they're also recruiting from GATE exam for the technical entrance. Just look and see here. So senior field engineer, senior field officer in telecommunication sector, senior research officer in crypto sector, and then senior research officer in S&T in cabinet secretary. So there are many government organizations who are directly recruiting from GATE examination. So obviously this is going to be very helpful for you, because even if you want to go for a technical entry in the government, so directly or indirectly, see why I'm saying it. Let me explain what I'm trying to say. These PSUs and these government jobs, they recruit from GATE examination directly or indirectly. How can I say directly? Directly means your GATE score is directly buried over there. So whatever your GATE rank is there, whatever your GATE score is there, on the basis of your GATE score, on the basis of GATE rank, they are going to recruit in their companies. But when I'm saying indirectly means the syllabus, they conduct their own examination, but the syllabus of those examination is based on the GATE syllabus. So whatever topics and concepts you are going to study in the GATE syllabus, all those topics and concepts are going to help you in the interview process, in the recruitment process, in the test process of these companies or these examinations. Okay, so here I have written junior engineer. So even if you are preparing for examinations like SSC JEE or ESE, engineering service examination, right? So the syllabus for ESE and GATE, they are very much like interlinked. If you are preparing for GATE, obviously you are preparing for SSC JEE. Obviously you are also preparing for your ESE, engineering service examinations, because ESE is conducted by UPSC. Though there is a small difference here. When I discuss about engineering service exam, then it is conducted by UPSC. Your civil services exam is also conducted by UPSC. So UPSC conducts your officer level job entries, examinations for officer level entries. But then your SSC conducts examinations which are below officer level entries. So junior engineers, assistant engineers, those assistant engineers, junior engineers are conducted by SSC. So again, the pattern, the syllabus, they are almost the same. Even if you see the ISRO examination, they take scientist entries. I think I forgot to write scientist entries here. So in other, I could have written scientist entries. So maybe your BART, Bharat Atomic Research Center, your ISRO, which is the Indian Space Research Organization, DRDO, Defense Research and Development Organization. So there are some of the government organizations who are directly recruiting on the basis of your GATE score, on the basis of your GATE rank. At the same time, some of these PSUs, some of these government jobs, they also conduct their own exam. ISRO conducts their own exam, BARC conduct their own exam, DRDO conduct their own exam. So you can see the examination for DRDO is September. I will update all the job vacancies throughout the course. So they also conduct their own exam, which is exactly same as GATE examination. And they also give some previous GATE questions in their examination. So obviously, if you are preparing for GATE examination, you are also preparing for these scientist entry jobs in the government organizations. So obviously, the importance of GATE examination is very, very high. And as I said, these higher studies, that means M.Tech and M.E., for these M.Tech and M.E. in IITs, in top IITs, top universities or colleges, for example, top IITs, IIT Bombay, IIT Delhi, IIT Madras, IIT Guwahati, IIT Kharagpur, and your IIC Bangalore, and top central universities, like you have Banaras Hindu University. So now, earlier it used to be a central university, but now this Banaras Hindu University is an IIT. You have Aligarh Muslim University. So the top universities in India, they take people for M.Tech or MS or ME directly from GATE examination on the basis of your GATE score, on the basis of GATE rank. You apply in those colleges and then they recruit you for M.Tech or MS. Okay. Now we will have a more discussion, more detailed discussion regarding M.Tech, what is a TA job, what is a RA job. We will have a more discussion regarding this. And what is this PhD? Why I have written this PhD? So this is a very interesting part here. If you have more than 75% in your B.Tech, and maybe you have written one or two research papers, and you got a very good GATE score, very good GATE rank, and you are good in academics, maybe your 10th and 12th percentages are also good, maybe 80% plus, right? Then you do not have to go for masters. You can directly go for PhD. So it is going to save a lot of time for you, because obviously in M.Tech you are going to spend like 2 years, and then again you are going to spend 1 year to prepare for PhD, then you will get a PhD. So almost you are going to save 3 years of your life if you prepare for GATE and directly go for PhD after the GATE examination. So obviously this is also a very good option, but again for this option you have to work hard. Iske liye thoda sa aapko hard work karna padega. Otherwise all of these options are easily achievable. Everyone can really achieve it. Everyone you can really take all of these options. You can really get a job. You can really get a good M.Tech and PhDs, right? So we will discuss about all of these in more details. So I will discuss more about GATE examinations in more details in the upcoming videos. So I hope this video was a little helpful, because as I said, for private jobs, it is better you prepare for GATE examination. For PSUs, you have to prepare for GATE exam because they recruit from GATE exam. For these government jobs, right, scientist entry, teaching entry, because for teaching entry, you have to do M.Tech, right? And obviously, the institute from where you are doing M.Tech, that matters for teaching job, right? So again, here also, you have to prepare for GATE exam. And for these higher studies, again, you have to prepare for GATE exam. So there are a lot of career opportunities, a lot of new venues that will open up for you guys if you prepare for GATE. Okay. I hope this video was helpful for you. Let us move on to the next video. You will definitely like the next video. Okay. Thank you so much for watching. All the best.